This show is part of the RetroZap.com podcast network.
Hey, this is Lauren Mary Kim, and I'm the stunt double for Ahsoka Tano in Clone Wars and the armorer in The Mandalorian. You're listening to Dennis and Jay on Podcast Stardust. This is the way.
This is Podcast Stardust.
This station is now the ultimate power in the universe.
With Dennis Keithley and Jay Krebs.
Your behavior is continually unexpected.
The galaxy source for Star Wars news, reviews, and discussion.
Now witness the firepower of this fully armed and operational battle station.
Hello, I'm Dennis Keithley.
And I'm Jay Krebs.
And welcome to another fully armed and operational edition of Podcast Stardust. So this is the galaxy source for Star Wars news, reviews, and discussion. Before we get to this week's edition of our The Empire Strikes Back review, Jay, where can we be found around the internet?
We can be found on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram at Podcast Stardust. And we can be reached by email at podcaststardust@retrozap.com.
So we are now in part 8 of our ongoing series looking at The Empire Strikes Back. And this segment will begin at roughly 1 hour, 16 minutes, and 40 seconds if you're on the Disney Plus version, which picks up right after Boba Fett starts tracking the Millennium Falcon. And it ends at about 1 hour, 26 minutes, and 33 seconds. And our guest this week is Joe Corroney, who many, if not most of you, will recognize as the Star Wars artist who's put out an incredible amount of spectacular Star Wars art over the years. And this is quite a good conversation that we're about to get into with Joe.
Yes, it is. And, you know, being the creator and artist that Joe is, and just his history and upbringing with Star Wars in general, has really set the tone for his life and for our discussion. So we really do have a fantastic deep dive into this segment of The Empire Strikes Back. And I think that everyone is really, really going to love this. And, you know, Joe is one of those artists too that I think a lot of people don't realize that they've seen his work a lot. He has so many things out, even like puzzles, for example, that you can get at Target. His artwork has shown up like the propaganda kinds of things that we've seen so many times for The Empire. So, you know, he's definitely one of those artists that he's been around a lot and you may not even realize it. Kind of like the Force.
Well, we got a lot to talk about here, so let's go ahead and dive into our discussion. We are now pleased to welcome noted Star Wars artist for Lucasfilm and Disney, Joe Corroney, to Podcast Stardust. Joe, welcome.
Hey, Dennis. Hey, Jay. Thanks for having me.
And Joe, you're someone that we've been wanting to get on the show for quite a while. I mean, you are known for doing work in a lot of different fandoms and genres, but particularly Star Wars, and that's of course what would be of most interest to our listeners. And we figured one of our Empire Strike Back episodes would be an ideal place to have you come and talk, because quite frankly it's widely renowned as one of the best, if not the best, Star Wars movies out there. But before we get to the discussion of our segment, Jay and I have some general Star Wars questions that we ask of our guests that join us for these segments. Sure. And just kind of going over your experience with The Empire Strikes Back. And so I'll start off with this one. Do you remember your first time seeing The Empire Strikes Back? And if so, what do you recall?
Oh, absolutely. I think it was right before my 8th birthday. I'd seen Star Wars, A New Hope, but it was just called Star Wars back in 77 when I was like barely 4 years old that summer. Back then, everyone on the planet was highly anticipating the next Star Wars film. So what I remember the most is standing in line. This is in Indianapolis, Indiana, where I grew up, and watching, going to see the film. The movie theater's not there anymore, and I can't remember. It was on the east side. But standing in line, I think the movie theater had maybe 4 screens, maybe. It wasn't a huge theater, but the line just wrapped around the theater twice. So we were in line all day that summer day in May, just waiting for our showing. We got there early, my mom, my dad, me, my brother and sister, and just standing in line all day and the anticipation of that line just sort of wrapping around the movie. I mean, that's unheard of, really. You do get lines for Star Wars movies. They're more like events now, but back then that was really unheard of. So yeah, I just remember standing in that line and just for like what seemed like hours. I mean, we were probably there for in the morning until sometime in the afternoon we got into our showing. And once we got into the theater, they had the big lobby cards, which they don't really do anymore, but there were lobby cards on the wall. So as you're waiting for the movie and you're standing in the theater outside the auditorium, so many memories, actually. I remember seeing the lobby cards. I remember once the movie started, there were certain visuals that were embedded into my brain that just I carried with me all through childhood. At this point, I already had the action figures. I was already a huge Star Wars fan, so I was on board from day one and had all the toys and the action figures. And then I had probably 3 or 4 mail-in Boba Fetts before the movie even had come out because my mom had cut out the little Kenner. Yeah. So I was stoked. I was ready for this movie. And, you know, the Battle of Hoth, I still even remember the first time I saw the AT-ST in that quick second, or those like 3 seconds of it in the background passing on screen. And I remember telling my friends, you know, on the playground, like, yeah, what about that other Imperial Walker, you know? And they're like, what are you talking? I'm like, you know, the little one that had 2 legs, and no one believed me. And I was like, no, I remember seeing it. and back then you didn't have VHS. Well, we didn't have VHS yet, so you couldn't really replay the movie and stuff like that. So you had to go back and see it, you know, multiple times that summer. But stuff like that. So, I remember the audience cheering like loudly at the end of the movie, which again is something that just doesn't happen these days when you go to the movie theater. I mean, some premiere nights they do, like maybe if you go to a Marvel film or a Star Wars film, you still kind of get that. But back then, like, I remember standing on my theater seat because I was little. I mean, I was like 8 years old, barely. And I remember standing on my theater seat and applauding with the rest of the crowd, you know, when the movie finished. And it wasn't the most happy ending, obviously, for a Star Wars film. But everyone loved the movie so much and they were so excited and felt so fulfilled that, you know, to have that memory of everyone on their feet applauding a Star Wars film in 1980, just that stays with me, you know, to this day. So this just kind of reminds me of how special these movies are, and they still are to me.
That is absolutely fantastic. And what an incredible recollection. I mean, I'm sitting here and, you know, I can just about see everything through your eyes as you're describing it, which, you know, you are an artist. So that's not surprising to me that you would be able to describe things in such amazing detail. And wow, what a special memory that is. So cool.
Yeah.
So cool.
Oh, thank you. Yeah. That's how much these movies meant to me. I mean, of course I love Star Wars just like anyone else does. And it's in my blood and everything. But to me, Star Wars is what kind of made me, like, it informed my youth and it informed my dreams and my hopes and everything I wanted to do. Like, I knew as a kid I wanted to be an artist and I loved drawing Star Wars. And when I was 8 years old, did I know I wanted to be a Star Wars artist for a living? Not really, but I think once, as I got older and kept making Star Wars art, you know, I was always drawing on that inspiration from the Star Wars films and the toys and the comic books that kind of informed and guided me.
Absolutely. You know, that was such a substantial experience for you personally that it really did, like you said, it informed the rest of your life. And what a profound thing to have been able to experience at that age. That's incredible. That's incredible. That's a gift. It really is a gift.
Yeah. I think Star Wars for our generation, you know, when I say like guys my age and girls our age, it hit at that right time. Like, there are a lot of artists and got actors and filmmakers and craftsmen and all kinds of talented, creative people that can really look back on these films and, you know, that's their inspiration for what they do for a living. So, and I feel lucky in that regard. These films came out right at the right time for me, being at such an impressionable age, but there was nothing really like, you know, Star Wars or Empire Strikes Back or Return of the Jedi. So those films are kind of like just part of my DNA now. But I feel lucky in that regard that I was kind of at the right age at the right time when these movies came out.
Sure. So, you know, being as it is that you've had such a profound experience with all of these movies, you know, Dennis had mentioned earlier that, of course, Empire Strikes Back is considered one of the, if not the best Star Wars films of all, but where would you personally rank the movie across all the films?
For me, it's definitely definitely one of my favorites for sure. I would put it, it's kind of a hard thing because we wouldn't have Empire without the first Star Wars film. And the first Star Wars film, I have even just as many vivid memories and recollections of that as well. So to me, like A New Hope is really probably my favorite Star Wars film just because of the purity of it, because of it being the first and of it sort of introducing me to this galaxy or far, far away. That's why it's probably my favorite. Now, Empire is definitely the best written, the best acted. It has the best art direction. It has the best lighting, the best cinematography. I mean, everything. So it's everything times 10 when compared to the first Star Wars film. So in that sense, it's, to me, it's the best. Empire is definitely the superior film. And then in that sense, you know, I would say A New Hope, Empire, and then, you know, I love The Last Jedi quite a bit too. So that would probably be pretty high up there, right underneath Empire. So yeah, Empire is probably my first or second favorite for sure.
Okay. You talked a bit earlier about the Battle of Hoth, but is that your favorite scene, or do you, what would you call your favorite scene from The Empire Strikes Back?
That's a good question. I don't know if I've ever even really considered that per se. I'd have to dwell on that because the whole movie is just so perfect from start to finish. I remember as a kid, the scenes with Yoda training Luke on Dagobah weren't always my favorite. So those were the ones I would tend to kind of fast forward. Cause I'd watch these movies on VHS over and like literally every day before school and after school growing up. Once I had these films on VHS, or if I recorded them off HBO, which I had done when they first went on HBO before we officially owned them, I'd watch these movies every day before school, like a half hour here, 20 minutes there. And I would do this with all three Star Wars films and then also the Indiana Jones trilogy all through like grade school and high school. So that said, I would watch Empire Strikes Back very often growing up. And then I would kind of fast forward through the Yoda stuff sometimes just because it was a lot of talk and exposition and a lot of deep philosophical stuff that probably went over my head at the time. But growing up, I came to appreciate those scenes much, much more. The stuff that Yoda was teaching Luke and Luke, you know, being impatient and being frustrated, which isn't always the most fun stuff to watch. But then as I got older, I came to appreciate it more. I would say, I don't know, that's a tough question. So the stuff, you know, the lightsaber duel, of course, on Cloud City between Luke and Vader. I mean, there's so much emotion and so much drama, and it has less to do with the action and more to do with what's at stake for the characters. So to me, that is probably one of the best Star Wars scenes. Some of the other Star Wars films where maybe even the prequels where the emphasis is more on action with the lightsabers and how cool the choreography, and Duel of the Fates is one of the best looking Star Wars lightsaber battles ever. And there's a lot at stake there too, especially when you hear Dave Filoni talk about it. But to me, some of the lightsaber battles in the other films are more about the action, less about the internal character drama and conflict. But Empire Strikes Back, to me, that is probably the best lightsaber duel between Luke and Vader on Cloud City.
That's awesome. And, you know, and it's so cinematic, as you said, from start to finish too. And I have to say, if you were like me, I did the same thing as a kid. You had them all, you know, taped off of HBO, and you made sure that you popped out that little tab so that nobody taped over it. Am I right?
Yeah. I remember. Yeah. Oh my God.
Yes,
kids are
definitely.
Like, what are you talking about?
Oh, I know. Yeah. But, hey, that's okay. Yeah. So obviously Empire Strikes Back did introduce some new characters to us, some very notable characters, and some characters that we were obviously familiar with from A New Hope. But if you had to pick a favorite character in Empire, aha.
I'm just gonna say I know, yeah. There's no hesitation. Yeah.
I see this.
Yeah. Well, because between A New Hope and Empire, you have to really put yourself in that mindset. Nowadays, entertainment is so quick and so instant gratification. But back when we were kids, it was 3 years between Star Wars films. There was,
right.
That was like the longest wait ever. So knowing that there was a character that looked as cool as Boba Fett was coming out and going to be in the next Star Wars film, and he was this really mysterious bad guy. And the only thing we got was the Star Wars Holiday Special with the cartoon. Or if you were lucky enough, like my mom mailed off for the Boba Fett action figures. And, it's, you know, I had so many of those little Kenner UPCs. She mailed off for like three or four of them. she would do that for me with like every mail in too. I had like 3 Admiral Akbars, I had like 3 Boss, but Boba Fett was sort of the first mail away Star Wars action figure. And I remember getting this figure and just being like, wow, like I can't wait to see this character. So the hype in between, I think it was a few years before the movie had even come out when they introduced Boba. And then when you get the action figure like a year before and you're just playing with it every day. And finally you get to see this character realized on screen and in live action, and he looks so cool. He's so little, and that stuck with me. And now, granted, kids or young, maybe even newer Star Wars fans or younger Star Wars fans, they've had the opportunity to sort of be introduced to the character in different ways, like through the prequels with like Daniel Logan as young Boba. So once you get to the prequels, they kind of demystify the whole Boba Fett storyline, which isn't a bad thing. I love that. But people are always like, well, you know, why do you love Boba Fett so much? He's so overrated. He gets beat up really easily, falls in the Sarlacc. He doesn't do anything. But I'm like, yeah, but before the prequels and before the Clone Wars cartoon, like he was like a really mysterious character, very enigmatic. And his design by Joe Johnston and Ralph McQuarrie was just like so perfect. And his costume told so much story and it had so much detail and character. So if you put yourself in the mindset of the classic trilogy, you know, 20 years before the prequel trilogy, then you know, if you're one of those older Star Wars fans like me, and then you're like, you understand why Boba Fett has such a huge fan base. As a Star Wars artist and as a storyteller within Star Wars, I've loved getting to work with the character, just getting to kind of, you know, just illustrate him or tell stories with him or sneak him into illustrations and here and there. My second favorite is Darth Vader, especially because of Empire Strikes Back, but Boba from Empire is definitely my favorite.
Yeah, I know what you're saying when it comes to the buildup with that character, because I too had the mail-away Boba Fett action figure before the movie came out, and really being enamored with him and everything he could do. And it was not even one of those things that I considered until years and years later that he didn't actually ever get to do much during the course of the movie.
Right.
When you're a kid, he just had that look and he was so mysterious and he said few words and just was awesome. So yeah, I completely understand that.
As kids, we just, with these Star Wars films, we tend to like, as younger kids growing up with these films, we just sort of filled in the blank with so much imagination when it came to these characters. So there was, I think, playing with the action figure and that, you know, or the toys or, you know, drawing the character, all that stuff, like as a kid, that sort of created even more excitement and mystery, I think, in a lot of ways. So.
Right. And then he's kind of the successor to how cool the stormtroopers looked with the helmet and the visor and everything else he's got going on. The last question we have for you before we get into the segment that we're going to talk about is, of course, back in 97, we got special editions of all these movies. And the majority of changes, of course, came in A New Hope. But when you're just thinking of The Empire Strikes Back, do you prefer the original theatrical version or the special edition of the film?
It's interesting because of the special editions. I think The Empire Strikes Back is probably the one that has the least amount of additional material added to it. I mean, I know they shot brand new scenes for the Wampa encounter on Hoth, where they added some more shots of the new Wampa suit they built for that. You know, there's not a whole lot added per se. I mean, what they did for the special edition of Empire was just a lot of cleanup and a lot of refining the details. And one of my favorite things they did actually was opening up Cloud City with even more visual effects. So it doesn't feel as much like, not that it felt low budget before, because it didn't, but it felt, I guess maybe they felt more like movie sets per se. And I think with Empire Special Edition, they opened up the city more, they added windows, they put more color into the scene. It feels more like a sci-fi city in the cloud, fantasy place, as opposed to just kind of like, you know, look at these cool walls, look at these cool hallways and stuff. So it felt more lively and more vibrant. For the most part, I love almost all the upgrades the Star Wars films got in the special editions. There are some things that I'm on the fence or that I don't like, but I think for Empire, it's all been, I think, just to elevate it. And to me, I don't think anything detracts at all. I think all the visual enhancements and everything they added to me was pretty good.
A lot of that shows up in the segment that we are going to be discussing tonight.
The Cloud City. There's a little bit of Cloud City in there, I think. Yeah.
All right. Well, then let's get to the segment here. And for those of you following along on your favorite podcatcher, we are starting at 1 hour, 16 minutes, and 40 seconds if you are on Disney+. Otherwise, we are picking up right after Boba Fett starts tracking the Millennium Falcon. And we get back to Dagobah, where we see Luke training. He is standing on his hands, and he starts levitating boxes and then R2. Meanwhile, Yoda's standing nearby, telling him to concentrate and encouraging him to be calm, and that he's going to start seeing things through the Force and other places, the future, the past, old friends long gone. And I think he kind of plants a nugget there in Luke's head, because right after he says that, Luke's eyes get real big and he says, "Han, Leia," and then everything crashes. And Yoda admonishes him, "Control, control, you must have control." Luke reveals that he's had this vision where he sees a city in the clouds, and Yoda says, "Yep, you've got friends there." Then Luke notices that they're in pain. He asks what's going to happen to Han and Leia, and then Yoda reminds him that, you know, it's difficult to see, the future's clouded. And so this is where Luke is getting ready to abandon his training and do the impulsive thing that's going on here. But what about this training moment stands out to the two of you? And
okay, good. I'm glad that you're choosing to focus on this. There was something that I've always picked up on in this training scene that was interesting to me, but it's specifically after Luke has his vision and he tells Yoda, you know, "I had a vision, a city in the clouds, my friends Han and Leia." And Yoda tells him, he says, yeah, it's the look that Yoda gives right after Luke asks him, you know, "Are they going to die?" And Yoda pauses and he closes his eyes. It's almost like he taps into Luke's vision. And I always thought that was interesting because it's Luke's vision of Bespin and his friends hurting and in danger, which we don't see. It's just told to us. But after Luke informs Yoda of this, there's a brief pause from Yoda and he closes his eyes and kind of lowers his head, and it's almost as if he's tapping into Luke's vision. Is he just considering what Luke is telling him, or is he really seeing Luke's vision? Which goes to show just how powerful Yoda is to me. And it's a little thing, but I always found that really compelling, that even as Yoda taps into Luke's vision to see what he's seeing, if that's what he's doing, that even Yoda can't see past that. So it's an interesting use of the Force, I guess, that I've always found very particular. And like, you know, can other Jedi do that? Is Yoda the only one that can maybe possibly see someone else's vision that they just had? Or are they both reading an alternate future together? I don't know. I found that really compelling. And it's just that little character beat, that little character moment with the puppet where Yoda closes his eyes and he kind of sighs and pauses, and it looks as if it's like he's really trying to see into Luke's future or into that vision. So yeah, I mean, I think that little piece stuck out to me. I always been kind of curious how other people felt about that.
You know, I have to be honest, this is one of those things that, having seen the movie as many times as I have, just kind of flies right over my head that Yoda's got some idea of what Luke's talking about. Because typically, right, when you think of these visions in all different areas of Star Wars, whether it's the TV shows or whatever, no one else sees the vision. They have to tell them about it. But Yoda seems to know what he's talking about. That's a good point.
Yeah, that's very thought-provoking. I mean, everything that you've just said, because honestly, I have never thought about it from the perspective of Yoda looking into Luke's vision. I guess I always thought about it in terms of almost like a crystal ball, that these visions were, what do you see when you look into this crystal ball? It's all about the perspective of the character and what they're seeing. Mm-hmm. But I'd never thought about it from the standpoint of him actually tapping in, you know, like going through the same conduit, the same kind of channels.
Yeah. And it seems like we've only ever seen that happen with Yoda, with a vision, but a Force-sensitive vision between two Jedi. I mean, you've only ever seen it in this one scene where they have like a communion almost. And what makes me think that he is tapping into Luke's vision, that he can see what Luke has seen, is right after he closes his eyes, after Luke says, you know, "Are they going to die?" Yoda closes his eyes and lowers his head, and he pauses, and then he opens his eyes and says, "Difficult to see." So it's like, did he just try to see past that moment that Luke couldn't see past? and maybe Yoda can't see past it either? Or is it just Yoda saying, you know, hey, it's your vision. I don't know. It's difficult to see. But to me, it feels more like Yoda because he pauses and tries to tap into what Luke is seeing. It's like, oh, he can see Luke's vision, which is really interesting to me.
And I think it's interesting too that Yoda says difficult to see. So is it really difficult to see, or is he just kind of almost baiting Luke in the way that he doesn't want to tell him what he's seeing so that Luke can make up his own mind to that, you know, hoping he can't reveal too much because he may be wary of what Luke will do or how he will react.
Exactly. I mean, you could totally read that into that, and that would be even a little more meta because Yoda sort of, he doesn't, he knows how powerful knowing too much can be, which is exactly why they don't tell him about his dad. So they don't want to give him too much information, but maybe, to me, I think Yoda in that moment is sincere. Like, it's almost to me like he, because he does pause and you can see it. And this is the mastery of the puppet. I mean, this is the mastery of Frank Oz's performance, of Stuart Freeborn makeup and puppet work and building Yoda. I mean, just all of that emotion and feeling in his face where he just kind of, it almost feels like he wants to help Luke. I mean, he does. He doesn't want to hold Luke back, but at the same time, he's cautious. But in that moment, he doesn't seem as cautious to me. And that's just me maybe being a little more hopeful, but that's how I feel.
Right. So we've got Luke expressing some doubt here, and after Yoda doesn't give him a definitive answer, and then the scene changes to Bespin in Cloud City, and the Falcon is being pursued through the cloud by two cloud guards. We see Han there in the cockpit, and he's arguing with these cloud guard pilots. No, I don't have a landing permit. I'm trying to reach Lando Calrissian. And then 3PO makes a comment about, oh, they're rather touchy after they fired on the Falcon a little bit. And Chewbacca utters something to which we start to get a little bit of the hint of the backstory, what's going on here, when Han responds, that was a long time ago. I'm sure he's forgotten all about that. And then we get our first views of Cloud City. It's, you know, this giant platform floating in the clouds. And finally, the pilots come through and say, you've got permission to land on platform 327, which is, of course, a rather famous Star Wars number. Then as they're pulling in, Han makes their remarks like, hey, there's nothing to worry about. We go way back, Lando and me, to which Leia responds, who's worried? That's all great. But then the real meat of this scene happens as they land on the platform. We get some great sweeping views of the city that were added in the special edition, as you're mentioning earlier, Joe. This is what the special edition was all about, as far as I'm concerned, was adding this great science fiction, fantasy, space opera environment, really making Cloud City look like something special floating there amongst the clouds. And the sun's kind of setting there, so you get a lot of the oranges and the reds and the yellows bouncing off these white buildings. The Falcon lands, they disembark, and 3PO notes that, hey, there's no one here to meet us. And Leia says something, oh, I don't like this. Han goes to reassure everyone, says, look, don't worry. Everything's going to be fine. Trust me. And as Lando's walking in, Han says to Chewbacca, yeah, keep your eyes open, huh? Because he doesn't believe anything. He just told Leia. Then this is the first glimpse we get of Lando, and we're over halfway through the movie already. And I don't think I ever realized how late he showed up in this movie until I sat down to make my notes for this discussion, that for someone whose name is fourth in the credits on the movie poster, Billy Dee Williams is not in that big a chunk of the movie.
Right. I think that's a testament to these films. I know even if you think about Yoda, even though he's not on the, an actor on, Frank Oz is, but I mean, like, as a character, he was even also mysterious to a lot of degree, and he doesn't, but he's the most iconic character probably from the film, other than maybe Boba Fett, is Yoda, and he doesn't show up until probably halfway, well, before Lando, obviously, but much later in the film. So, and something I always thought was even with in A New Hope, you know, Luke, we don't get introduced to Luke until, what, like maybe 20 to close to 30 minutes into the movie? I mean, the first time we actually see Luke is, and the movie doesn't start with Luke. I mean, he shows up kind of late as well. So that's what I think these characters are so iconic, like Lando. Yeah, it's Billy Dee Williams, and even at that time, he was a movie star. And getting him in the film was a big deal. So people were excited to see him. But his character and his performance is so iconic that we kind of forget, like, oh, wait, he's only in like a little bit of the movie. That's a testament to him as an actor, to the character, you know, to the writers, to introduce this really, I mean, he's almost as mysterious as Boba Fett. Like, Han talks about him and you're like, who is this guy? Like, this, you know, who is this? Han's past was also mysterious. So to tie someone into that was a really great idea.
So, Jay, I want to ask this question to you. Of course, this scene is famous, just like everything else, The Empire Strikes Back. But, of course, because Lando comes marching up to Han and says, why, you slimy, no good, double-crossing, no good swindler. You got a lot of guts coming here after what you pulled. And then Harrison Ford's pantomiming, pointing up at himself with that shocked expression on his face right before Lando fakes a punch and starts laughing. How you doing, you old pirate? So good to see you. What do you think, Jay, knowing what's coming later in the movie, was this Lando being genuine with Han, or is he trying to get him off his guard because he knows he's going to be turning him over to Vader and the Empire later?
You know, quite honestly, this has always remained one of the biggest mysteries in my head about this particular scene, was what was really going on in Lando's head at the time. Was he upset with him? And then kind of when he saw him, it sort of all melted away. Was he going out there kind of wanting to be all big and bad about it and then couldn't do it just because of the fact that here's this guy that he's been through so much with, kind of a thing. So honestly, I go back and forth on that one. I'm not really sure what was going through Lando's head. And honestly, I don't think we ever know what's going through Lando's head.
I think his nature is kind of duplicitous. So at least early on, I think he was genuine, but at the same time, he knew he had to catch Han off his guard. I mean, obviously, they're old buddies, and we've seen that now in Solo. The love-hate relationship, I hate you, I know, you know, classic line. So we know that there's a shared history, but ultimately, the fact that Lando goes to help save Leia and Chewie and to get Han, to rescue Han before he gets taken away, I mean, that says so much about Lando as well. So, yeah, he's selfish and self-centered, and he does betray his friends. But at the same time, he recognizes that he was caught between a rock and a hard place. I have sympathy for him. I know that Billy Dee Williams has gone on the record saying that, you know, Lando gets a bad rap. So, yeah, I mean, I think he was trying to catch Han off guard in that introduction. But he was kind of just winging it and kind of going. I think he was making it up as he went, like, oh crap, I got to, like, I'm going to betray my friends. But hopefully I can do something about it later to make up for it. So,
yeah, I agree with you both on this. It's hard to really tell what's going on here. And Solo, A Star Wars Story, does a lot in providing so much background to this one scene. I mean, it's already a great scene. But then when you think back to Solo and that final time that they sit down to play Sabacc, and Han walks up to Lando with that same type of bravado, is like, yeah, you know, you're lucky we're alive. And then he goes to throw a move, and then he starts laughing, and he, you know, hugs Lando and then steals the card out of his sleeve and stuff like that. So it's kind of the role reversal here, which of course no one would have known at the time that this was being written, but it was great that the way Solo set this up. Part of me wonders if Lando wasn't trying to warn Han by stating something that they both know was false there at the beginning, to maybe, but he was being watched by the Empire.
Right.
And so Han could have gotten back in the Falcon and left. But then, I don't know, it's hard to say
for
all the reasons that we talked about. But then, of course, we get the equally iconic introduction of Lando to Leia. Hello, what do we have here? And I mean, Jay, how many times have we imitated that on our show
over the past year?
It's one of our favorite lines. And then, of course, Han immediately gets jealous and he's like, all right, you old smoothie. And so he has to kind of break it up. And then Lando goes into businessman mode as he's kind of filling Han in about everything that's going on with the station. And again, without having known Lando's backstory prior to getting Solo, Star Wars Story, you already get an idea that this guy has evolved from being a scoundrel, as Han describes him earlier in the movie, to being a respectable businessman, as he describes him in the scene. But then when you throw Solo, Star Wars Story on top of this, you really do see how much this guy has changed, how much he's grown up, matured, and taken his life in a new direction.
Definitely. Now, there's one thing, though, I have to interject here for just a second that has always stood out to me, even from the get-go as a kid watching this movie. And it's when the, hello, what do we have here? And Leia doesn't introduce herself as Princess Leia. She doesn't introduce herself as Leia Organa. She says Leia. Like, that's just, that's it. That's all you need to know. You know, I'm with Han right now. I'm with this smuggler. I'm with this scoundrel. You know, how do you guys feel about that in terms of, you, why do you think that she didn't reveal, you know, like she didn't name drop? You know what I mean? Why did she keep her like entire identity kind of almost secret? That was the way that I sort of felt about it. So, Joe, do you have any feelings on that?
Yeah, I think it's because I think it might be the next. Versus the scene, it's the scene, yeah, she says it before, that she doesn't trust him. So I think that kind of is mostly, because even if she doesn't know the Empire's involved or not, I mean, they're on the run. They know they're on the run from the Empire, and any place they go could be compromised. So you have someone so well-known in the Rebellion, a leader of the Rebellion, as Princess Leia, as she's probably most commonly referred to by everyone who is aware of her and her position of authority in the Rebel Alliance. So, I mean, it can be read two ways, wanting to keep a low profile and possibly not trusting Lando or his associates that she's unaware of. Or it could be just Leia not having the, you know, maybe the presence of mind, because she doesn't have an ego as a character. She doesn't flaunt her royalty per se. I mean, she's very grounded. She's a very boots on the ground kind of leader, soldier of the Rebel Alliance. So I don't think she would necessarily refer to herself as a princess, even though she is one, or that she is royalty, unless, of course, she's in that particular environment where they're having to do diplomatic relations of some sort. But I think it just shows sort of the integrity of her as a character, that she doesn't have the ego, or she's just kind of like, yeah, you know, I'm famous. I'm not going to just throw that around either. I'm not a big deal. It's okay.
Mm-hmm. Right. Yeah, I think there's something to all of that, and especially considering they're on the run. And why put out there that Leia, this well-known leader of the Rebellion, is here at the station. She doesn't know it, but you know, I have to think that having been with the Rebellion as long as she did, that she knows that there's an APB put out amongst the fleet, the Imperial fleet out there. And so throwing her name around is probably not the wisest idea in this case. So Leia's sufficient in this instance. So the movie then progresses. They move inside, and as Lando is kind of giving them the tour, and we get more great interior views, especially in the special edition view, 3PO gets distracted by quite possibly the rudest protocol droid in the galaxy. And his door opens, and 3PO says, oh, it's good to see a familiar face. And then this droid, I don't know, is it the first instance of a Chuta we've ever heard in a Star Wars movie or Star Wars content? At least it's the first that comes to mind. And so 3PO then hears an astromech chirp, and he wanders into this room to investigate. And we don't see who he's talking to, but we immediately get this, who are you? And what do you want? And then 3PO starts backpedaling, and oh my, so sorry, didn't mean to intrude. No, don't get up. And then 3PO gets blasted into bits, and the door closes right as Chewbacca is coming back to look for him. Of course, we've all seen this movie countless times, and we know what was going on there, that he ran into some Imperials and Stormtroopers, and they shot him. But did either of you recall the first time you saw this, what you thought was going on maybe during that scene?
For me, I'm just sitting here trying to think, and I thought that, you know, C-3PO was a goner. I really did.
Yeah, I think so. I mean, I remember that particular of who blasted him. I don't remember thinking other than, well, the bad guy's got him, and I don't know who did it. And then, of course, then get a little older, it's like, oh, yeah, those are obviously stormtroopers that blew him up. Beyond that, I remember thinking, as a kid like Jay, like 3PO, they, like, I think it was a smart move in the story to kind of up the stakes at that point, because you get such a beloved character like 3PO, and you totally destroy him, and which totally raises, now granted, obviously, they put him back together fairly quickly after that, but still, I thought he was, like, totally dead. Like, when I saw that as a kid, I was like, okay, 3PO's gone. But then, of course, a little later, they relieve all of that worry, which is a great thing that they probably did for all the kids in the world who were worried that 3PO got destroyed.
Right. The story then returns to Dagobah, and Luke apparently didn't have any second thoughts, because there he is, preparing to leave the planet. Yoda and Obi-Wan are pleading with him that he can't go, he must complete his training, and then Luke is protesting in response that I can't get the vision out of my head. I have to go help Han and Leia because they're going to die. And then Obi-Wan's like, well, you don't know that. And this is kind of gets back to what we're talking about earlier with the vision. What you're saying, Joe, is that as much as Luke is protesting that Han and Leia are going to die, Obi-Wan's saying, well, even Yoda can't see their future. So either he did tap into that vision, or he was using other Jedi powers to try and investigate what it was that Luke was talking about. But there is a lot that is goes on in this conversation, just like any conversation that Yoda has. Just a couple of things. One, Luke is pleading with him, I can do this. I can feel the Force, which now kind of reminds me of Finn telling Han when they get to Starkiller Base and they're trying to figure out what they're going to do once they're there. Finn says, we'll use the Force. And Han says, that's not how the Force works. I almost, Obi-Wan is much more polite, saying, you have no idea what you're doing with the Force. You can't control it, which also is kind of surprising because they had conversations in A New Hope about whether the Force controls you or if it obeys your commands. And now Obi-Wan's explicitly saying, you can't control it.
Right.
But then Yoda brings up the cave. He says, remember your failure at the cave. And Luke says, but I've learned so much since then. Do you think he learned anything since the cave where he fought the specter of Vader and ended up slicing what was essentially his own head off?
I think what Luke is referring to, what he learned there, is just that he's learned that he's tapped into this potential within himself. I don't think he's necessarily learned anything from his failure. I think he's still wrapping his head around, why is my face in Vader's mask? I mean, the farthest thing anyone would think, even us as an audience at that point, is that our hero character, our main character, is the son of the baddest villain of the galaxy, of movie, of filmdom, you know? So I think at that point, audiences couldn't even wrap their head around that either. So Luke saying that he learned so much, I mean, I think it's all just sort of superficial, that he can lift rocks, that he can do flips, that he can, they're all things that a Jedi can do, but they're not really necessarily the things that Yoda, the other more important things that Yoda was trying to instill in him about do or do not, there is no try, look at my size, don't judge me by my size, things like that, that the Force is not just something to lift rocks with, it's an energy that is much more important and to a Jedi. So I don't think Luke, even though he says that, something else about that scene, when it ends with Luke, with Yoda telling, before it cuts to Cloud City, when they're back on Dagobah, once Yoda tells Luke, like, yeah, you can't help your friends. You got to stay here and finish your training. And then it cuts to Cloud City. But right before it cuts, there's a look on Luke's face where he kind of resigns to what Yoda said. He nods and kind of agrees with Yoda, like, yeah, I'm not going to chase this dream. I'm not going to follow this vision through. Then after it cuts back from Cloud City, back to Dagobah, like you said, Luke is sort of just not even giving it a second thought at that point. It almost feels like something has changed in that quick, however many minutes have passed or however many hours have passed at that point, Luke is like, okay, no, I'm going to help my friends and you can't stop me. So that I always found kind of interesting, that we don't know what really changed his mind in between the scenes other than he gave in to his impulse, which is fine. That's all we need to know. It works for the story. But to me, it's like, okay, but what was it that really kind of pushed him over the edge to say, I have to go now, even though I agreed with you earlier that I shouldn't go, but I'm going to listen to my teacher. And he nods in agreement. Then next thing he's climbing up the ladder on the X-Wing, like, okay, I got to go. Sorry, I can't stay. So I thought that was really compelling. Again, these are just little details we think about, like, what was it that pushed him over the edge? What else did he see, maybe, in his, did he have another vision? Who knows?
What do you think, Jay?
Well, the way I relate to it is now, of course, in my own life, is as a teacher. And Joe, you've done some teaching as well, with your artistry. And, as a master, you have a completely different knowledge base than someone who is just starting out. So even though you want to encourage that learning and you want to encourage the successes that your students have had, sometimes their little successes to them are so huge, but realistically, in the grand scheme of things, it's not that much that they've learned, but they get so excited about it. And they get almost like, as the Emperor said, your overconfidence is your weakness. And in this case, it really could very well be, because you're, you're overstepping what you think, you know, where he says, I've learned so much since then. And like you said, yeah, maybe there was some introspection and there was some self-reflection and he was able to garner some lessons from that. But, you know, as Dennis said, did he really learn anything? And so, you know, I think that there's that novice versus master perspective going on there as well.
Yeah, I think there's a bit of an ounce of knowledge is pretty dangerous in this case. And I think the other aspect of this is that what Obi-Wan and Yoda are trying to warn him about is going right over his head. And they are masters. And even though they've taught younglings and have had Padawans, they're having a very hard time breaking this down for someone who's essentially an impetuous teenager that they just started teaching about what is going on here and what is the danger. Because Obi-Wan says to Luke here, this is a dangerous time for you when you're going to be tempted by the dark side of the Force. And Yoda says, yeah, yeah, listen to Obi-Wan. And that's when he brings up the cave. And I think, Joe, you were absolutely right when Luke says, I've learned so much then. It's like, yeah, I've learned how to levitate rocks. I've learned how to swing from vines and things like that. Mm-hmm. That's not what Yoda and Obi-Wan were talking about. And then the conversation then proceeds. And they think they further, I think they further confuse him, because they say, they warn him that the Emperor wants Luke for his ability. And Obi-Wan says, I don't want to lose you like the way I lost Vader. And of course, they're holding an essential truth from him, which would probably help quite a bit, or maybe not, or maybe send him off to Cloud City even faster. But Yoda goes on to say, stop, they must be, on this all depends. Only a fully trained Jedi Knight with the Force of his ally will conquer Vader and his Emperor. So I think in that point, Yoda's realized, I'm not getting through to this kid, so I need to tell him that you aren't trained as well as you think you are, that you need to come back and finish this up. But also, I can't help but wonder if Yoda in this moment is still stuck in the past in an old way of thinking, because in Revenge of the Sith, Yoda was a fully trained Jedi Knight and he couldn't defeat the Emperor. Obi-Wan Kenobi was a fully trained Jedi Knight and he temporarily defeated Anakin, but they didn't get the job done then either. And then they proceed from this point in the conversation to fall back on some things that they highlight, which we'll see in The Phantom Menace when they're talking to Anakin about don't give in to hate. That leads to the dark side. When Luke asks, well, should I sacrifice Han and Leia? And then Yoda says, if you honor what they fight for, then yes. He's essentially saying no attachments, which is kind of this old Jedi way of thinking. And so this scene has got a lot going on, but I think a part of it is Obi-Wan and Yoda are talking over Luke's head. And then Luke is not asking any he's not asking the right questions. And perhaps Obi-Wan and Yoda are falling back on some of the flaws of the Jedi of the Old Republic. What do you two think?
Oh, I agree. Absolutely. I mean, everything you said is pretty much spot on in my book, with Yoda still kind of in the old mindset. Now, granted, when we saw this movie, we had no idea of the Jedi history, the teaching, and all the history that came with those characters. But we just kind of take it as face value as Yoda being the wisest Jedi master and the guy that taught Obi-Wan. So, but now that with the prequels and the benefit of having the prequels part of that conversation now, I agree. I think it's not that it's wrong necessarily to be cautious or to stick with, because we know there are flaws in with no attachments and a Jedi shouldn't love. And we've heard that argument from Anakin in episode 2. So I think, not that Yoda's wrong, but I think we understand his cautiousness even better now. And it doesn't mean it's necessarily still right, but I think they are talking over Luke's head. And I think Luke isn't asking the right question, because he has no idea of what he's really, what's ahead of him, what's been behind him, the history of the Jedi. So it's kind of it's a forced situation, because even though it seems like in the movie, Luke's only there for like maybe a few days, maybe if really, I think he actually does spend more time on Dagobah training than what we see in the film. And if I can remember right, I think I want to say it's almost a month that he's there. And it's almost a month from, even though we don't see that play out in real time in the film, obviously, but especially because the characters are wearing the same clothes, I think Han and Leia are actually traveling, escaping the Empire, and they're on the run for almost that amount of time. So even though Luke is on Dagobah for more than what we see in the film, whether it's a week or a few weeks or almost a month or however long the novel says, I can't even remember, but he's there long enough, but not long enough to, I guess he's there long enough to learn, to train, to get some force abilities, but he's just not there long enough to really contextualize what all of this means. And it's still, they're kind of under a very high pressure, very quick, rapidly paced situation where, you know, all this stuff is happening outside of Luke's life with Han and Leia, and he's sort of forced to hurry up and do something about it. So it feels like he needed way more time on Dagobah than what he got. And I know it's more than a few days. I want to say it's at least some weeks that he's been there, but it's still not enough time.
No, definitely.
Mm-hmm. I agree. It's, you know, it's hard to wrap your head around the time frame too, because I guess that's something that I thought about in passing in terms of how long he was actually there, but never really thought about nailing it down like that. And I know there's been some discussion with some of the other movies too, that, oh, did you know that this movie took place over days and not weeks, or hours instead of days? And so it is kind of hard to wrap your head around that sometimes, but I always felt like Yoda and Obi-Wan in some ways did sort of talk over Luke, as you said, almost like two parents having a discussion about their child in front of their child. And so, you know, it was always kind of that sort of feeling of mentorship, but also the added parenting kind of thing. And then on top of it, like you said, you know, Yoda's almost got this PTSD in a way from, you know, just having everything happen the way that it did. And of course, at the time, we didn't know about Order 66 and we didn't know how it all went down. But, you know, reflecting back on that, you can see kind of where Yoda is a little afraid to let him go.
Mm-hmm.
And I guess fear is not a good thing, obviously, because fear leads to the dark side.
Definitely. Yeah, they explicitly say that. But then the last thing of significance is that Luke takes off in his X-Wing and he says that he'll return and finish what he started. And he makes this promise, which she alludes to then in Return of the Jedi. And as he's flying away, Yoda can't help but get that last word in with Obi-Wan. You know, told you I did, reckless he is, now matters are worse. And so Obi-Wan comes back with, that boy was our last hope, to which Yoda responds, no, there is another. Now, we all know who that other is at this point, that it was Leia, the other Skywalker, and separated from Luke at birth. But back then, I have to admit, when I was a kid, this line just washed right over me the first several times I heard it. It was not until I was older that I started to even consider what it was. And by that time, we'd already had Return of the Jedi, and I knew. But did either of you have any thoughts on this the first time you saw it? Or within the first couple of times you saw it before Return of the Jedi came out?
No, like you, I was the same way. Like, it went over my head. And by the time it really had an impact on me, we were seeing Return of the Jedi in 1983 in the movie theater. So I was like, oh, wait, yeah. So we didn't have the benefit of rewatching Empire whenever we wanted as kids. So, I mean, I think at that point, it wasn't probably till after Jedi when I would watch these movies on VHS. But yeah, so that line, going back and sort of rediscovering these films growing up and realizing, wow, like there's so much more to these films, especially with like a line like that, that they were really thinking ahead. I guess my angle from it comes because I know that with my involvement with Star Wars, my knowledge of the lore and all of it, that the fact that Luke and Leia were even brother and sister wasn't something George thought about until he was well into his second or third draft of Return of the Jedi.
Mm-hmm.
So that wasn't something he had planned in Empire. And obviously you can tell because they end up kissing in the movie, and they play with the whole love triangle aspect of Han, Luke, and Leia. So when George was writing Return of the Jedi, the script for that film after whenever Empire is done, he needed a reason for Vader to push Luke in anger in Return of the Jedi to get him to push him towards the dark side so that Luke would get angry at Vader and lash out and almost kill him. When George was writing that, he thought, what can I do to get Luke to be that angry? And it's like, wait a minute, let's make Vader threaten Leia and let's make it personal. So it wasn't until he was writing Return of the Jedi, whatever, second or third or fourth draft, that he decided, yeah, Luke and Leia are brother and sister. Now, with that in mind, which totally makes everyone have to retcon the kiss and Empire Strikes Back and all the flirtiness and the New Hope, and wow, she's so beautiful and all that stuff. But with that in mind, going back to Empire, like, well, did George always intend Leia to be Force-sensitive as well? Because he most certainly didn't intend them to be brother and sister, which is really interesting, which means maybe he wanted Leia to be Force-sensitive, or was that sort of, maybe wasn't thinking of Leia at all. Maybe George just threw that line in there from Yoda saying that, no, there's another, because he wanted to add to the mystery of the story. Maybe he had another idea for Return of the Jedi. I mean, that's what I would like to know, because it wasn't because he always intended them to be brother and sister, because we know that's not the case. I mean, you could read into, you know, the making of The Empire Strikes Back by Jonathan Rinsler, or you can read into the making of Return of the Jedi, and you can learn this stuff. So, but what I don't know is, like, what with that line, you know, and I'm sure someone has the answer. Maybe I just didn't read that part, or it's over my head right now. But it's like, you know, what, to me, it's like, what, you know, was it really Leia that at the time when George wrote that line that Yoda was referring to? I would like to think it was, because now it makes complete sense. It's like, well, there can't be anyone else. It has to be Leia. But back then, you know, what was he really thinking? Because they weren't brother and sister at that point in the story, in the creation of the saga. So it's really interesting to me. So that's how I come about that. That's the first thing I think of when I hear that line.
That is intriguing. And I've never thought of it from that perspective myself before. Because, of course, you know, you get so wrapped up in, oh, what you know now, that it's nice to be able to take a step backwards and say what was really happening at the time, you know, when this was being written and what was going through George Lucas's head. And, you know, I know for myself, that line went right over my head as a kid, you know, thinking, oh, there is another, well, who might that be? But then never really gave it another thought. But I love that analysis of where that may have come from. I think that's extraordinary.
There's a little quick anecdote I'll throw in here at the end for this, that when Damon Lindelof ended the TV show Lost for ABC, George Lucas and Damon and Carlton Cruise, the creators of Lost, were huge, huge fans of Star Wars. It's obvious in all their work, and especially Lost. And so when the series ended, I think Damon reached out to George Lucas, or George reached out to Damon. I can't remember, but George wrote Damon a letter, or I think Damon wrote George Lucas a letter thanking him for all the inspiration. George wrote him back and said, like, basically, I created Star Wars like you guys did Lost. Like, I didn't have it all thought out ahead of time. I made it up as I went along, too. Like, basically, don't give me too much praise to think I had this all planned out, like, to a T, because I didn't. Basically, he said, you know, he complimented him on the fact that when they wrote the series Lost, that they were kind of making up the mystery and the mythology of it as they went along. And that's exactly what George did. I mean, obviously he had a lot of it thought out, but when it came to these scripts and to filming, he was still like, okay, what happens if we introduce this idea? Let's throw this in here. Let's see what happens. So it wasn't all like as thought out as a lot of Star Wars fans might want to believe. I mean, obviously it was to a large extent, but there are things that were left, maybe things that were put in that sort of like they made it up as, like, you know, like Indiana Jones says, I make it up as I go. You know, that's kind of what George did to a certain extent with these stories. So I think that's very reflective in the relationship between the familial relationship between Luke and Leia being brother and sister. That wasn't really part of the plan until writing Return of the Jedi. So that makes you think, like, well, what if, okay, like, if they weren't really brother and sister until Return of the Jedi, what was the other really Leia? And if it was, how did she come about her Force powers? What was her story? So, but now we know it's all kind of the Force runs strong in the Skywalker family. Ah, that makes much more sense. There we go. Okay.
Yeah, I do remember hearing somewhere along the line that when the scope of these movies was, you know, 6, 9, 10 movies, whatever it was in George's mind at the time, that the idea that some additional person was going to show up in a later chapter that would be this unnamed other that they're speaking of here at the end of this conversation. But then, of course, as you said, it changed when the Return of the Jedi mm-hmm. came along. So
yeah, that's interesting. That's good to know, because that makes kind of sense to me in a way, knowing that. So
that brings us to the end of Luke with Obi-Wan and Yoda there on Dagobah. And really, that's the heart of this segment that we've been talking about, other than what's been going on with Lando there on Cloud City. But we get one final scene, and that returns us to Bespin. And we get another great view of a cloud car flying through the city and getting us great views of the city. Then we are left with a window where Leia's pacing back and forth, and then Han enters the room and he says, you know, great news, the ship is almost finished and we can leave soon. To which Leia just goes off. The sooner the better. Something's wrong here. 3PO's missing and no one's seen him for 4 days. And Han just immediately kisses her on the head. So that's interesting that they kind of gotten that familiar, that they've settled into that. Even though they had the steamier moment earlier in the movie while they were repairing the ship, it kind of has been this thing that's broken off since then. And she doesn't recoil from it. She kind of accepts that kiss on the head. They sit down and Han calms her down. He says, relax, I'll talk to Lando. And she responds, I don't trust Lando. And Han says, I don't trust him either, but he is my friend, which is kind of ridiculous, because is he really your friend if you don't trust him? But that being aside, Han says, you know, besides, we'll be gone soon. And then Leia says, then you're as good as gone, aren't you? To which Han returns that sheepish, I don't know, look that he in response. So we didn't really get an opportunity to address kind of the Han and Leia banter with you, but what do you make of this scene in relation to the rest of the movie?
I think you've made some really good points, especially some really good observational points about how they kind of have this, you know, are they together in each other's mind or are they not in terms of a romanticized relationship? I mean, do they even know the fact that Leia doesn't recoil when Han kisses her on the head? I think there was also an edited scene that was cut out that would have probably helped that scene a little bit more, where they have a little bit more of a, they share a second kiss, I think, in that scene, in that set. It just didn't play right, or it didn't work for whatever editing reasons or dialogue reasons. But it kind of informed that they had spent a little time on Cloud City at this point, and that maybe things have progressed a little further than just the kiss in repairing the Falcon. But yeah, and it's not a necessary scene. But I see what you're saying, and I totally agree. It's kind of like, well, are they or aren't they? But do they even know? And then also the fact that it's a good point that Han, he doesn't trust Lando. And now we, obviously after Solo, we also understand why as well. But they have this kind of shaky friendship relationship kind of thing. The banter in general is between Han and Leia is what really makes this film. It works so well in A New Hope. And I think they realized that banter, that chemistry that these characters have was undeniable. So to play that up in Empire Strikes Back was, of course, a genius move. I mean, regardless of, obviously people wanted Leia to be with Luke, you know, some fans, because Luke is the real hero of the movie, but Han is Han Solo, and he's dashing, and he's, you know, he's the one that, I think he's got so much charisma, you know, Harrison Ford. So, yeah, I love the banter. I love the strained relationship between the two characters, and that, it's perfect how it plays out in my mind and how it builds up to the scenes later in the movie. But yeah, those are all good points. Those are definitely really interesting things to think about that you pointed out.
And there's really so much compassion in this scene too. There's so much tenderness. And as you said, it's almost mind-blowing to think about where their relationship has actually progressed since that initial kiss on the Falcon. But I love the dress, I have to say. I love that dress that Leia's wearing. And I always wondered where it came from. You know, did Lando really just have a bunch of dressmakers around that could just whip up a dress in her size?
It was
beautiful and functional. Of course, you know me, I'm always focused on the fashion.
Yeah. It's like Padme. Like, where did she get all those amazing dresses? Did she travel with 30 dresses all the time? But it's like with Star Wars, you can't really like question it. You're like, well, I guess she got a dress while she's on Cloud City from some, you know, like Lando hooked her up somehow.
Absolutely. And this is one of the only times that we really ever see Leia pacing like this, you know, and being so impatient. There's some other times where we see her, you know, unbalanced a little bit. And the one that comes to mind is in The Last Jedi, when they come out of hyperspace and she's just kind of, you know, with her own thoughts and her little hydro flask kind of rattles as they're coming out of hyperspace. But you don't really see Leia off of her game much, you know, in terms of,
that's true.
You know what I mean? She's not one to really be very, very unbalanced. But so I think it's kind of profound.
Well, and I also like the idea that knowing that she is a Skywalker in retrospect of 2020 Vision, when she's so flustered there, I can't help but thinking, again, this may not have been their intent when they filmed the movie, but she's sensing the dark side surrounding them there on Cloud City with Vader's presence and the stormtroopers, and that's why she's so easily agitated in Han, despite the fact that 3PO has been missing for days. And then, you know, she says, you know, something is wrong here, and she can't put her finger on it. So, again,
yeah, I think a lot of that, I agree. I mean, and I like that idea that it could be, in hindsight, maybe she does, you know, because she is force sensitive and she doesn't even know it, but yet she's bothered by the presence of, you know, what's really happened.
All right. Well, that brings us to the end of the segment that we're going to discuss tonight. So, Joe, thank you so much for joining us. You had a lot of great insight on this section of the movie. But before you go, why don't you tell our listeners where they can find your work, where they can find you around the internet, and what you're working on these days?
Let's see. Well, you can just find me on the internet at Joe Corroney, at joecorroney.com. And then, I mean, I'm pretty easy to find. All my social media is from my official website. You can find me on Facebook and Twitter and Instagram. I'm on Twitch and YouTube now, which I need to get back on there soon. So I've been doing some drawing videos and stuff on my channel. So yeah, feel free to look me up there. I just a few weeks ago for Comic-Con, I had a new Star Wars poster come out, which was a really limited release thing with Ahsoka. I know Jay ordered one and there ended up being a mishap with the shipping, which is really unfortunate, but don't worry, I got you covered. I'm going to hook you up. we're going to work around that. But yeah, I had a new Ahsoka poster come out, a limited edition thing with Lucasfilm and Trends. And then Star Wars wise, I got a few things I'm working on that I'm hoping I might have some new art that'll come out around celebration time, hopefully. And I got some other projects coming out, one for Supernatural. The TV show is coming to a series finale, so I did a special poster with the WB through them for that. And so that I think that might be coming out this fall. So yeah, feel free to follow me online, and I'm always updating and sharing artwork, and always happy to talk about Star Wars, obviously, with anyone who will listen. So.
All right. Well, again, thank you so much for joining us. It's been a fantastic discussion.
Yeah, thanks for having me.
Absolutely.
All right. So that was our discussion with Joe Corroney, and there was a lot to unpack in that conversation. And what happens always in these discussions seems to have happened again here, that you go into with this with a 10-minute segment that seems rather tidy, but then as you dive into it, there's just more and more and more to explore as we go.
Absolutely. And, you know, like we were saying even a little bit before and after we were recording, is that it's incredible how the segments that we pick and the guests that coincide with those segments really do kind of really speak to each other in that way. And it's a very personal thing to each of our guests. And I'm not sure if that's a product of just happen to be rewatching it at the time, or if it's just kind of meant to be, you know, that these segments really do speak to our guests in the way that they did. But thanks again, Joe, for lending us so much amazing insight.
All right, then. That will do it for this episode of Podcast Artists and our discussion of The Empire Strikes Back. And I'd like to remind you all that we are part of the RetroZap Podcast Network, and you can find all episodes of Podcast Artists over on RetroZap.com. You can also subscribe to Podcast Artists on Apple Podcasts, Stitcher, Overcast, or wherever it is that you listen to your podcasts, including the RetroZap Podcast feed. If you've enjoyed the show, there are a few things you can do to help us out. First, spread the word about Podcast Artists on social media and make sure to tag us when you do. Also, please consider heading over to Apple Podcasts and leaving us a 5-star rating and a brief review about what it is you like about the show. And with that in mind, Jay, can you remind everybody one more time where they can find us on the internet and on social media?
Sure. We can be found on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram at Podcast Stardust. And if you want to connect with Dennis over on Twitter, he is at DJKVER2, and I am at Joyce Krebs. You can also check out our Pinterest page and our YouTube channel, and we even have an email at Podcast Stardust at RetroZap.com. Not surprising, but if you'd like to drop us your thoughts over there, you certainly can. And if email's not your thing, you can always join us on our Discord page, or our Discord room, I should say, on the RetroZap Discord server. And we are just one of a lot of different shows over there, different landing rooms for different kinds of conversations. And you can always support us on TeePublic, where we are teepublic.com/user/podcaststardust. And you can find all of your wonderful Podcast Stardust goods over there, from stickers to masks and t-shirts, sweatshirts, and just about everything in between. And thanks to Corey Club from Coffee with Kenobi for producing all those great show logo designs for us.
All right, that'll do it for episode 144 of Podcast Stardust. Thanks for listening, everyone. And until next time, may the Force be with you.